Welcome back, Cyclone fans, to the latest edition of the Nightcap. I'm your host, Aiden Wyatt, along with Matthias and Levi. Guys, how we doing?
Not too bad. Playing not shitty basketball, so that's something.
Oh, we're so back.
Did you know dead skin cells are the main ingredient in household dust?
Yes, I did know that, actually.
Yeah, I think that's pretty common knowledge.
There you go.
Thank you.
Thanks, Matthias, for that.
You're welcome. In other news, the USFL draft is going on right now.
And I was looking through the rosters, and there's only like three players that I ever heard of on there. And that one was Jordan Ta'amu, Kyle LaLetta.
Hold the phone. Breaking news. Tyre Catalina has been drafted.
The Catalina line fixer?
He has been drafted.
Catalina line fixer is now in the USFL. Look at that.
He is alive and well. Selected at the 8th pick in the 5th round.
Huh.
Let's go.
There you go.
He's I'm assuming, and I don't know these logos just yet, but it looks like, what the fuck team is that? Oh, he is going to, he's going to Tampa Bay.
Oh, the horse, the bandits.
Yep, Tyler Catalina.
There you go.
So now I think we have to establish who all our favorite team is.
Yeah, I'm still deciding, I guess.
Like I said, that's going to be 2D determined.
Yeah, still deciding at the moment, but based on uniforms alone, I think I'm gonna go with the New Orleans Breakers.
The thing is, if you wait for all the players to be drafted, and you're just a bandwagon,
fan,
pick a team now.
I'm gonna pick the Breakers. I'm gonna pick the New Orleans Breakers specifically because of the uniforms. I'm a big fan of the uniforms. Yeah. And at this point, how could you pick? Like, what else could you possibly be picking these teams on?
Oh yeah, absolutely nothing. Like, we chose ours because we were like, New Jersey seems real gritty, you know.
Yeah. Yes, New Jersey is super gritty.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, anyways, what are we doing for our episode today, Aiden?
This is kind of doing a little mailbag, talk some Iowa State basketball, and. Obviously, we're going to talk some USFL as the rest of the world is talking about right now.
Yeah. We're going to be the one and only podcast in the state of Iowa talking about the USFL.
We're claiming that right now. The one and only.
Mm-hmm.
We created the idea, just like Iowa created the color black.
I can't believe you tweeted, Matthias, the one time Iowa State commit is now in the USFL. That is the most tangential connection of all time. Yeah. Didn't even play here. Just was verbally committed for about a minute and a half.
One time commit.
And people have to know this is the news they've been waiting for all day.
This is crazy.
Just saying. Line fixer. Yeah.
So
who could forget?
We should say thank you to our sponsors. It's Das Barn Group.
Looks like you got it. You've already started.
Do I have it? Okay. everybody can, whenever you're looking for some good food names, head on down to a Stoss Bar and Grill down there in Campus Town. Got their Taco Tuesday special, which is happening right now. Burger Wednesday. They've got 11 to 3, $6 unlimited tacos every single day. Game day specials, all that good stuff. So definitely head on down there for some delicious food. They still do delivery and all that good stuff too. So. Definitely head on down there for some good food and some good drinks. It's a great place to watch a game too.
And you can watch the USFL there.
You can watch USFL games at Estas. Assuming they also, I don't know what channel those games are getting broadcasted on, but
Fox and NBC, everybody knows this.
Well, this I didn't apparently.
Quite the fan you are.
Apparently. Jesus. Yeah.
And you're on the one and only podcast in the state of Iowa that talks about the USFL and you don't even know what station they're on.
Correct. That is exactly what's happening here.
Oh my god!
Yeah. So, yeah.
Speaking of Tuesday, why are we celebrating the 2/22/22? I didn't think it was that big of a deal, but I've gotten like 30 emails from different stores and stuff saying we have deals for 2/22/22.
It's an excuse to send out a marketing email. Basically, is what it is.
Never pass up the opportunity to make a sale, Aiden. This is a fact of life.
There you go.
Noted.
I don't know. It's just one of those like quirky things that people like to latch on to. Like, I don't know. People just like to latch on to weird dates and shit like that. I don't know. It's not my thing, but.
Too bad we don't have a date that has 69 in it. That'd be sick.
I mean, unless you go like June 9th of 1969.
Doesn't count.
I mean, 69. I don't know. I don't know what else you could possibly want.
Yeah.
No.
Or it was like when in 2006, June 6, 2006, people were like, oh my God, it's the day of the devil, 666 or whatever like that. And I was like, 6606, but you know, but yeah, beside that.
2012 when the world was going to end.
Yeah.
Still here.
Yeah, we're still here. We're still here.
So, Aiden, you said we got some mail. What do we want? What are we starting with? Mailbag or what do you, you want to mix it up a little bit? What do you?
We can start with some mailbag, you know, we'll start with this heater.
So we can start with mailbag. I'm sure there's mailbag questions that'll lead off into other stuff. Yeah. So
this is from at Joe B WHOA says, got a fun one for you. The wife is pregnant with our first child and she's a Hawk fan. How can I convince her to let us bring the baby home in an ISU onesie?
As I responded to him on Twitter, it's either the baby comes home in the Iowa State onesie or the baby gets returned. Her choice.
Or the wife stays at the hospital.
What?
You just bring the baby home. Wife.
Yeah, or the wife stays at the hospital.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You had three options. Choose wisely.
Convince her to bring it home in an Iowa State onesie is tough.
No, it's not.
Well, yeah, I guess.
I mean, but just hold her at gunpoint.
Why?
Well, maybe not. It's not okay, this
is horrible advice. yeah, I don't know. I don't know if I have actual practical advice for that for convincing your Iowa alum. I guess you'd have to trade something that like the kid's gonna be like wearing Iowa, like an Iowa onesie for the baptism or something like that.
The real question is, did he know that she was a Hawkeye fan before he married her?
Yeah, that's kind of the actual question here. The real follow up question is why he's gotten himself into this mess in the first place. Yeah,
this seems like his fault.
Yeah, it's definitely a you problem. That's for sure.
And all right, that's how we help him.
Yeah, that's how we solve that.
And we just end it.
Marriage. Yeah. That's our advice.
I didn't know you were a Hawkeye fan.
Get a divorce. Yeah. Get a divorce. Okay, next one. From at Trax182, which take is hotter? Iowa State will win the conference football next year, or Iowa State will win the conference tournament this year for the men's?
The hotter take is football. Because this team, the basketball team is good enough this year that they're good enough on defense that if the shots are just falling for a few games in a row in Kansas City, they can easily make a run. Like, that's not... I don't think that's even outside of the realm of possibilities that they could make a run and take that tournament title. But for Iowa State to win a football conference title next year, in my opinion, I mean, it's going to take the offensive line getting better, quite a bit better. And it's going to take Hunter Deckers being every bit as good as we thought he was going to be. And the defense has to be really good. You have to see like Will McDonald and Bo Freiler both just completely dominate on defense and hope you get a couple linebackers to step up. Stuff like that. There's a longer road. It's a more difficult path for Iowa State to get to a conference football title next year than the basketball team, you know, getting hot for a couple days and getting a Big 12 tournament title.
It's a good segue into the next question here. Who do you think is going to be the toughest opponent next year for football?
The toughest opponent or the game I think we're most likely to lose?
We can do both.
Matisse, you can go first.
The toughest opponent?
The best team that Iowa State will probably play next year.
Hard to say it's not Baylor.
It could be Baylor.
Oklahoma is going to be flying around on defense.
Oklahoma's going to be down. Their offense, they just lost so many pieces.
Yeah.
I mean, they'll probably still be good. Like, they'll probably still be like 8-4 or better, but they're not going to be unbeatable.
Their defense is going to be legit, though, I think.
Maybe. I don't know. They lost a bunch of defensive pieces, too. I mean, the scheme will be better, but are the players any better? I don't know.
I mean, probably 4 and 5 stars, I'm sure.
Well, that's what they've always had, though. I mean, Oklahoma's defense has always had 4 and 5 stars. So, I don't know. It's just, I mean, Oklahoma State, I think, will be good. But I guess I don't know. Because, like is the guy behind – is the guy after Spencer Sanders – I guess question one, is Spencer Sanders coming back?
I don't think anybody knows.
I don't know if that's been decided or not. I don't know if Aiden can look that up. But if Spencer Sanders is not coming back, then I think – then there's a serious question on there, who takes over after Spencer Sanders. And Jaylen Warren is gone. They're running back. So – you know, I mean, it's not that they can't reload at those positions, and, you know, they've always got a good wide receiver or two. Brendan Presley, Brendan Presley is back.
Spencer Sanders is coming back next year.
Spencer Sanders is coming back. Okay, so that helps them for sure. And that defense should probably be pretty good again. Oklahoma State might be Baylor's got a little bit of has a little bit of a quandary on its hands, I think, because I think they did lose some pieces on they lost some pretty important pieces on defense. Now Bohannon is back at quarterback, so that helps.
Well, just think, they're having everyone return. A lot of guys returned from a Big 12 championship team last year, and I'm pretty sure that works out most of the time, as far as I know, when a bunch of players return for an extra year.
Yeah, don't
quote me on that. But
it usually works. Yeah,
don't have any proof that says otherwise.
But yep. Baylor, I mean, they were good last year, but they were kind of similar to that 2019 team, where they had a lot of bounces go their way. And that's just, it's hard to replicate. Kind of like in 2020, when Iowa State had a lot of bounces go their way and had a good season. And then, you know, in 2019 and 2021, where they didn't have a lot of bounces go their way. And you end up on the
other end. That's a lot of fumbles.
It ends up a lot of fumbles and a lot of weird fumbles and bounces and shit like that. So I guess in the... the best team they're going to play is probably either Oklahoma State or Baylor. The game they're most likely to lose is Iowa, in my opinion.
Nah, it's Kansas.
Boo.
I know.
Boo.
I don't like playing in Kinnick.
First, you don't know what channel the USFL's on. Then secondly, you pro out this crap.
I know I'm going to get buried in the comments, but you know, Iowa's defense is gonna be really good. Hunter Deckers is only gonna be playing the second game as a starter, you know, and they're going into Kinnick. I don't know, unless that running game is really productive right off the bat, which I think it can be. Jarrell Brock's really good, but if that offensive line looks like it's still having some issues against Southeast Missouri State, mm-hmm. like if it looks like it's still not awesome, I'm not going to feel great about that Iowa game. Not that they can't win it, and not that they don't have a decent shot at it, because Iowa's offense is still going to be booty. But their defense is really good, and they get lots of turnovers, lots of timely turnovers, and that's not – I don't know.
I know one way they can make the
– we match up so bad with Iowa that it's hard to be confident trying to win that game in Kinnick.
I know a way to make you more confident. And make the challenge less daunting from a crowd factor.
Okay.
We move the game to Carver Hawkeye Arena.
Oh, yeah. Nobody will ever know what's happening there.
We could probably buy out Carver Hawkeye.
Because yeah, we could probably be
too close to Des Moines, so we probably wouldn't be able to make that one.
Yeah.
We got a wind factor that people wouldn't be able to walk from their cars to Carver. Some high school football games that are going on that people won't be able to make the game at Carver. Some other factors, wind chill, crazy.
Yeah.
Tickets are too high priced.
Yeah.
$8 is a lot.
$8.
For someone who doesn't have a job.
Yeah.
Like me.
Oh.
Yeah.
Very well.
It's only because Wide Right doesn't have any child labor laws.
That's the only reason we've been able to hang on Aiden all these years. So what's up next?
We got a real hard question here. Is cereal a soup?
Is cereal a soup?
Yeah.
So.
No. It's cereal.
So, I don't know. I get why people, like, do these things where they, like, try to recategorize items based on, like, the general composition. I'm not really, like, big into that. Like, everything's a sandwich or everything is either soup or a sandwich. Like, I'm not in that crowd. So, I would lean towards no. Because, like, to me, the differentiator is, like, a lot of cereal is at least kind of sweet. I mean, unless you get, like truly right. Cornflakes or something like that.
Yeah.
Like, to me, a soup is not sweet.
Also, a soup is like hot. With broth. You know, so like
maybe with broth, soup is hot typically. Like, I mean, where cereal is never hot. I mean, unless you're talking like oatmeal and you're talking literally hot cereal.
Yeah.
But like, to me, there's a couple main differentiators between cereal and soup. I don't think you can throw them in the same category.
There's also the following question: is a hot dog a sandwich? Which I say it is, by the way.
See, for me,
I dare you to drive your ass to Chicago and say a hot dog is a sandwich and see if you come out alive.
I'm not gonna do that.
For me, a sandwich has to have like a sandwich has to have two separate pieces of bread.
But what about now? Hear me out. You ever been to Subway?
Yeah.
Do you know that they don't have two slices of bread?
I worked at Subway. So
so you get it then. You know how it's just
you really don't. Nobody ever like plans to eat a hot dog with the two sides of the bun separated. Like if it's separated, it's considered a failure. Whereas like if you have a Subway sandwich and they don't cut it all the way through, but you're eating it and it just rips open into two pieces of bread anyways, it's still very recognizable as a sandwich. Whereas like
thing.
If a hot dog bun like rips in half on the bottom and you just have like a half of a hot dog bun on a disconnected hot dog bun on each side of the hot dog, like that's that is abnormal. That is atypical.
Here's my thing. You say that a hot dog with essentially two buns is a failure. But what if
failure is probably not the right word, but it is an aberration.
What if that hot dog was just trying to become the best version of itself?
I can do that.
All you can ask for. It's all you can ask for.
So, if here's my differentiator. If you have a hot dog bun and it's intact with the bottom still sealed, all nice, it's a hot dog or whatever. It's just a normal hot dog. If the bun rips and it becomes two separate buns on each side of the hot dog, one on each side of the hot dog, then it becomes a hot dog sandwich, but it is not a hot dog as you would typically define it.
Let me change this up a little bit. you know when you get like a hot dog in the tinfoil wrap at a baseball
also,
game or whatever?
Quick shout out. This is a very correct take. Blimpy is...
What's a Blimpy?
Blimpy is a... there's not a lot of them around
anymore. You've never heard of Blimpy?
Blimpy is a sandwich place. There's
B-L-I-P-P-I.
There's not very many.
For Blimpy, not Blimpy.
But Blimpy is very, very good.
So, you know, you get a hot dog at a baseball game. It's in the tinfoil wrap and it's like kind of steamed up a little bit. Yeah. And like, you know, there's some moisture in there and it just makes it taste better.
Yeah.
So my wife thinks I'm weird that if we like boil hot dogs at home, which whatever, just quick. And then I take the hot dog, put it in the bun, and then I hold it over the steam it up a little bit. Is that weird?
No.
You get that ballpark feel to it.
Yeah, well, and like I'm thinking, like if you look at like the Nathan's hot dog eating contest, they dunk theirs in water. It's not even just steam; they like dunk it in water.
Well, that's different. That's not for the taste.
It's making it go down easier, but that's right. Kind of what it is at the ballpark, though. Is it makes them go down easier with your beer? Like.
Well, yeah, but you're not. The aim of buying a hot dog at a baseball game isn't to see how fast you can eat it.
Well, right, but the aim of
jokes
aim
on of, you.
But the aim of steaming the ballpark hot dog is not to improve the taste. It's
Listen,
to make it go down easier.
There is no greater.
I thought Matias said it improves the taste.
Well, I mean, it changes the taste. I mean, you can say it improves it if you want. I mean,
it's not. Quit steaming your own. It's not so much that it just gives it more of the ballpark nuance to it, but But and you said something about it's not you get a hot dog at the ballpark not to see who can eat the fastest. But there's no greater pressure in the world of getting a hot dog in the seventh inning and have to eat it quick enough to get back to get another beer before they stop beer sales between the seventh or top of the seventh and the bottom of the seventh. That's pressure.
Sounds right? like a you then problem.
Get your hot dog in the sixth.
Yeah. Well, I already had one in the sixth. I mean, one every inning.
You ever get a hot dog every inning?
This is America.
That's too many hot dogs. I don't know what the line is. I don't know what the line is before at one before
America's hot, before greatest pastime. And you have but a beer and a hot dog.
Is too many hot dogs?
Says you.
says everybody.
So, yeah, that's too many hot dogs.
It's
man.
Too many hot dogs.
It's literally only seven by the time you get there. That's not that many.
That's Joey so, many hot, dogs.
So many hot dogs.
That is so many probably, hot dogs.
I definitely have not eaten seven hot dogs in the last year.
That's okay. way too many.
Honestly, I've never ate seven hot dogs at a baseball game. I'm just being. I'm making up a story here. All right.
That's still too many hot dogs.
I'm creating a scene. The
hypothetical is stupid. There's too many hot dogs.
Your face is stupid. Back to the O-line.
Okay, this is an actual good question here. What do we think
I'll
about
tell you, the O-line? I'll tell you what
yeah,
I think
of
the O-line.
Yeah, Matias is our resident O-line expert.
I'll tell you what I think. It's basically the same as last year, and if they don't fix their shit, it's not going to get any better. How about that? They got the other kid the tackle coming in that might help a little bit, but I don't know. They got more. It's not so much players that's the problem. I think they got some talent and some guys that can move people around up front, obviously. And then it also depends what they do at center. I mean, I think Downing's gonna be center now that Ramos is officially gone, but so you have Downing at center, you'll have Daryl Simmons at guard. Just depends what they do with the other guard spot. I mean, Grant Triber might get tossed in there too. I mean, they got some dudes. Anyway, the bigger problem is that they have poor technique and they lack the ability to push people off because of that poor technique. So, what we saw in 2020 was us playing good technique football up front and moving people off the ball and getting to the second level. And you can actually go back and look at some of these clips. These draft experts are posting of Breece Hall making people miss. And there's one clip out there. I think I retweeted it like a week or two ago, but Breece Hall at the second level, like literally the entire offensive line went the other way. And he was in front of like seven dudes, nobody there to even like attempt to block him. I mean, he made them all miss, but Jirel Brock is not Breece Hall or David Montgomery in that aspect. He's a lot less shiftier than those two. They got to block and they got to get to the second level and block and they got to create the lanes for Jirel Brock because you case in point, you saw, I mean, obviously Clemson is a pretty good stout defensive front up front, but in the bowl game, you know, Jirel is more of a straightforward, maybe one cut type of back.
He's a downhill physical runner.
You have to have the lanes. If there's no lanes, it's going to be tough sledding. So if they don't fix the technique problem, and I don't know, there was rumors out there that they shifted their entire blocking scheme. And if they did that, they should go back the other way to the one that they were doing in 2020 and just roll. So,
Yeah. No, well, and they've got three different backs in the backfield that they can kind of mix things up with. Cause I mean, Jirel Brock, Deion Silas and the third one.
Sanders.
Eli Sanders. Sorry, yes, not Jesus, Eli Sanders. Yes, I don't know why I couldn't think of his name. Eli Sanders,
first,
Deion Silas, and Jirel
you have
Brock.
The audacity to forget the TV network for the USFL.
What then do you know?
Then you trash us going into Kinnick, and now you call him Eric?
I know. I actually didn't mean to call him Eric, buddy boy. But anyways, so Eli Sanders, Deion Silas, and Jirel Brock are all different types of backs. You have a downhill power back. Deion Silas is a really shifty open space kind of guy. And Eli Sanders is a nice straight line. You know, he can make a cut here and there, but he's good dual, like catching balls out of the backfield and all that stuff. He's a nice all purpose back. But like you said, if Jirel Brock is going to be your lead back, they've got to start getting pushed and they've got to start opening up holes. I mean, otherwise it's just the running game is just not going to work. Cause I mean, it's not a knock on Jirel, but he's not like behind the line of scrimmage. He's not as quite the creator behind the line of scrimmage that Breece Hall and Dave Montgomery are, as Matias said. So you've got to get that fixed. And I mean, and like the offensive line has been in at least one phase of it has been an issue every single year, whether it's the run blocking is good, the pass blocking sucks, or it's the other way around. They've never been able to quite get the whole thing together where they've been very good, where they've been really good pass blocking and run blocking. I mean, 2020, they were pretty good. They were like decent at both of them, but they weren't like, I don't think they were like world beaters or anything like that. And they were also the beneficiary of some defensive lines that were missing a lot of depth and stuff like that too. So that helps. Yeah, I don't know. I'm optimistic about it, but I'm still cautious about the offensive line.
While we're on the subject of football, tonight Iowa State target Braden Dorman committed to Arizona.
Arizona, okay.
I think it was kind of thought that he was going to go to Oregon State for a while.
That's what it sounded like for a long time.
It flipped the other way. It seemed like it was serious at first, but it kind of really fizzled out. Kind of about the time JJ Cole came to camp here, that's kind of when it like flipped the other way. So
I'm assuming the staff kind of redirected their attention to JJ Cole.
You could say that.
It's a lot easier to target someone who's just on I-35 than it is in Colorado. Yeah,
they're both ISU legacies, so it's kind
right.
of like,
yeah.
So it's not like you're gonna favor one of them out of that. Mm-hmm. And JJ Cole is right down the way. They could get lunch together one day just because they felt like it. So, I mean, I don't know. It is what it is. It'd been nice to have him, but.
Speaking of recruiting, we got a question on the Discord is, how is our basketball recruiting class looked here this year or next year?
Like the 2023 class?
No, they didn't. I mean, I was kind of assuming they meant the one that's going to be coming this year, but that hasn't changed, so.
Yeah, I mean,
we don't have anybody for 2023.
Yeah, we don't have any commits for 2023. I'm not sure. I was kind of pulling this up.
I think Otzelberger's after some big fish, if you will.
Well,
I mean,
yeah,
we've had some decent.
Omaha Bilu is the main.
Yeah. We've had some guys visit.
He's got an offer from everywhere in the country, though.
Yeah, I mean, you're.
He's visiting, though. So, I mean, that's.
He's visited.
They're doing
times.
Something right, at least in that regard, I guess. But other than him, I mean, outside of him, there's some other bigger fish that are visiting and taking in some serious interest. So, I mean, if things go well, I mean, even if you get in the NCAA tournament this year, you're probably going to raise the stock for those guys as well. So, I mean, it all depends on how many people they can take. Because, I mean, well, I guess that'd be 2023. So there'll be a lot of scholarships.
And the tricky part with basketball recruiting, it's just a totally different thing than football recruiting. Cause you just like, I don't know. I'd never have a good feel for basketball recruiting. Cause So much of their tape is in AAU and stuff like that, where like, I mean, nobody plays defense in AAU, so everyone looks like an offensive superstar in AAU. And the offenses are kind of catered to feed it to the stars and stuff like that. Like, I don't know. I don't really trust a lot of basketball film that I watch. Maybe it's because I'm not as, I mean, I'm well, it's definitely because I'm not as seasoned or as knowledgeable necessarily on reviewing basketball film to be able to pick it out and say, okay, This kid is really good regardless of you know level of competition as opposed to like football. I think I know for football for a fact I have a better eye for football guys that play against lower competition than basketball guys. But so I don't trust basketball recruiting as much, and partially because like who knows if one of them is good, you know, it might help for a year, but what if they leave after a year or two? So, I mean, it's kind
of, I think a lot of it too, is going to depend on me. Cause I mean, we're almost to March. The season essentially could like, I mean, it'll be over in matter of weeks. Right. So let's say April 1 or beginning of April, the final four is
done. Barring a tournament run, I mean, it's over in less than a month.
Yeah, so April 1 hits or whatever, the Final Four is done, national championship game is over, you're going to see people transfer. I mean, we could end up with like a guy out of the transfer portal that's going to be here for 2 years. That could significantly change the outlook for scholarships in 2023. So I don't know if that's going to get really hot and heavy until, I mean, they're recruiting hard. Don't get me wrong there, but they're laying the groundwork as we speak, but I mean, I think it'll start to really take shape here once the season ends.
Yeah.
We'll kind of get an idea of what it's going to look like.
Well, yeah, you get the off season recruiting, get the summer AAU circuit and stuff like that. And that's when a lot of that stuff happens.
And it'll be pretty interesting to see how TJ works the transfer portal this time around, because last year, obviously it was a little different where it was like, we just need people,
You just need
bodies. So I'll be curious to see who he, or if he wants to even target
I bet they will.
I'd imagine they're going to need a shooter.
So from the 2022 class, we can look at those guys a little bit. So it's Damarian Watson, Eli King, and Taman Lipsey.
Eli King and Taman Lipsey, you got two guys that are really good ball handlers. Obviously, Taman Lipsey is going to be the guy that's going to be like a more of a pure point guard. Eli King's a guy that can handle the ball, be a point guard, but can also step out to the two guard spot and shoot the ball like no other if he wanted to.
It seems like to me like he can be Matt Thomas.
Yeah. Crazy athletic guy, can get to the rim, so that's good, which is probably also why he's a kind of a combo guard.
Yeah.
Watson was very highly ranked in recruiting rankings, if you're into that kind of thing. Struggled pretty bad last year in the AAU circuit, which is a lot of those rankings come out of. But like we said, you take AAU for what it's worth. I mean, if you're struggling in AAU, that's something to kind of watch, I guess.
Something to monitor, yeah.
But in his high school season, he's played pretty decent. He hasn't had any bigger fallbacks, if you will. So just another guy with some length and that can also get to the rim, can also shoot it. Just going to help, obviously. And then our Georgetown transfer coming in next year as well. So
yeah, Trey King.
Trey King, so that's gonna.
I don't know too
significantly
much.
It's a guy. He's athletic and
he's a scorer. Isn't he?
Are we seeing a theme here? We got athletic guys. yeah, it's actually gonna give a post scoring presence or a guy that can be at the rim. That's 6'9", gets the rebounds, but also score. So
the athletic part doesn't really move the needle for me a lot because Steve Prohm got lots of athletic guys. They're athletic and with good length. But it had just, you know, with the exception of a couple guys like.
Okay,
like
listen. When we're talking about recruiting here, if I came up and said, "Hey, this guy is not athletic," does that excite you?
Well, yes, but it raises a red flag for me when someone's like first primary trait is they're athletic. Like, yeah, they're playing college basketball. All of them are athletic.
This guy just ate a cake 5 minutes ago, and he's getting rebounds out there now.
Yeah. No, he's playing for the Pelicans and he hasn't played all season.
Damn.
Yeah.
I can catch him.
I don't care. We don't need to get into Zion Williamson, but like I don't feel bad at all about him about making fun of like all that cuz it's his own fault. It is. I mean, look at JJ Redick. Look what JJ Redick said today. He like lit him up.
I haven't been paying attention.
Oh, JJ Redick went on a show or a podcast or whatever and just basically called Zion a bad teammate because he's not getting his weight under control and stuff like that. And it's like, it's his own fault. But anyways, I saw so many people come in under Steve Prohm who's like primary traits were they're athletic and they have good length. But then like a whole bunch of them came in and they were not very high skill guys. Like I'm thinking like, Zion Griffin or like a Dudley Blackwell or something like tons of these guys that came in that have good length or athletic or whatever, but they're not good shooters or they're not great ball handlers.
Well, here's the thing, and I'm not saying you're wrong, but like compared to Steve Prohm, you know, TJ kind of likes to recruit defensive guys.
Sure.
Where he can really use that athleticism or the length a lot more than he could.
Sure. Yeah. And I don't disagree. I do think that TJ is more equipped to take advantage of those even if it's a low to medium to low skill guy that's really athletic and really in good length. TJ is probably more equipped to take advantage of that player.
Right.
But still a red flag for me. Like I still want to hear something like this kid can shoot or this kid is a good passer or whatever.
We've also been hurt these last couple of years, so
I am traumatized. I am emotionally
you have
scarred.
PTSD.
I am 100% scarred. I guarantee is what it is. But I mean,
I think Steve Prohm's at home eating 7 hot dogs in a matter of 7 innings.
Steve is just housing hot dogs during baseball games. It's certainly possible.
So, Damarian Watson and Eli King actually played each other not too long ago. I'm not sure if you guys saw that or not.
I remember seeing that.
Eli King, I think, finished with 21 points. Damarian Watson had 20. And Eli King hit a go-ahead jumper to cap a giant comeback, I think.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool to see. I think all three of those guys are somewhat close because, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think Eli King and Taman Lipsey play on the same AAU team.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then Durant Watson and King is play, from Minneapolis.
Yeah, then the Watson and King play each other and during the high school season.
Right, yeah. So that's, I guess, a good start for those three.
Yeah. I think those three guys are going to fit really nicely, and especially if they defend well, they're going to fit mm-hmm. nicely in T.J. Altsberger's system.
Aiden, do you have more questions? Because I got some.
Go for it.
And I don't even know where to start to answer these two, but I'm going to pair them together. But first off is, what are your thoughts on the Mets? And follow up, how does anyone stay sane by watching the Mets on a daily basis?
My thoughts on the Mets?
Like the New York Mets?
Yes.
I don't care about the Mets.
Who asked about the Mets?
Someone in our Discord. Really? His name is something in the Discord.
Huh. Yeah, you're right. He is right there.
I also do not care about the Mets.
I don't care about the Mets.
And I do not know how anyone would stay sane by watching the Mets because I do not watch the Mets.
I assume it's
the greatest pitcher of our generation. Just
Bartolo Colon, you're talking about.
I guess if you're going to stay sane watching the Mets, Javi's gone. He's with the Tigers now. So, yeah. Shit on you. You're out of luck. You have Javi Baez. Can't even watch that all year. That sucks.
And you only get DeGrom once a week. So it's
Wait, do they have Lindor, though, still, don't they?
I think so.
Yeah, so I guess there's that.
Yeah, well, you get DeGrom and Syndergaard. So, I mean, they got a couple good pitchers, but, like, you know.
Yeah, but Francisco Lindor and Javi Baez made for, like, one of the more fun.
Javi Baez is also one of the most profoundly overrated players in baseball.
Oh, boy. Here we fucking go.
You're a tour hater.
He's okay defensively.
Okay defensively.
He's good at picking runners off, and he's good at making flashy plays, but he's not as reliable as you think he is. And also, offensively, he is putrid. He's a horrible offensive player.
Oh, yeah?
You're a horrible offensive
player.
Yeah,
let's see you go out there and do it.
Yeah.
I'm not the one that's contracted to play professional baseball.
Well, there's a reason why. So why do you get the right to say that he's trash?
Because he is trash.
Get out of here.
Last year with the Cubs, he batted .248 as a shortstop.
Yeah.
Well, shortstop is a position, is an average, is a batting average position. It is not a power hitting position. And even if it was, he's not that great of a power hitter. His strikeout rate is astronomical. Like, he's like, as far as from a hitting perspective, he's an embarrassment as a shortstop.
I think you're overrating correlation between offensive and defensive positions.
Yep.
Because that's a lot more reliant on the batting order than it is.
Aiden.
Get him, Aiden. Go.
Strikeout rate is not reliant on batting order.
Get him.
No. I'm saying, like, if you're going to say the shortstop is a power hitter, I'm like, if they hit the four hole, then yeah, they should be a power hitter.
Right.
I think Javi batted first most of the time.
Well, that's fine. Then get on fucking base.
Yeah. What was his on base percentage?
I'm looking it up right now. So, per baseball reference, his on, well, let's see. That's just that. Oh, that's all advanced.
Hey, Levi, can I work through
base percentage right here? He was .292, which is not good.
Let me work through a scenario here with Aiden real quick. All right. I want you to stand here and listen to this, all right? Aiden, are you aware that Levi is a St. Louis Cardinals fan?
Who?
Jesus.
Were you also aware that, and maybe you've heard this rumor, but St. Louis is a boring city?
I hear that they're a poverty franchise.
I've heard that as well. And also St. Louis is a boring city.
I like St. Louis.
It is the armpit and the asshole of America.
So you've never been to Fort
Dodge. I've lived at Fort Dodge.
Speaking of Fort Dodge, did you guys see the Fort bowling Dodge team? Women's bowling team?
Yeah, it got banned for a while. Did we get more details on that?
Let me see if I can find something. All it said was like a cell phone violation or something.
St. Louis is such a poverty city that they couldn't even keep an NFL franchise. Unbelievable. Bush Stadium is a dumb name.
So, yeah, Chris Johnson, who is the assistant sports editor at The Messenger, I don't know where that is, he just tweeted bad news. The Fort Dodge Girls bowling team was disqualified from the state tournament for cell phone rules violation. More to come as we gather more information.
You want to talk about overrated baseball players.
We're talking bowling.
Yadier Molina is one of the most overrated catchers of all time. His WAR is like awful.
Anyway, back to high school bowling.
Got him.
Okay.
Struck to the heart.
Did I ever link to you that it was a Baseball Bits video about Yadier Molina and like the debate that goes on with like is he like the best catcher of all time or is he not? Or is he actually just kind of whatever? And it was like three parts of it is like if you look at his counting stats and all that for a catcher, he's really good. His durability is crazy. His WAR is like fine. It's not awesome, but it's fine. It's like it's compared with like Jason Kendall. Like which Jason Kendall was like good, but he wasn't like all time good.
His WAR is so bad it's telling us that there's a lot of more catchers out there better than him.
You know whose WAR is terrible?
Who?
Javi Baez.
Nah.
His WAR is terrible.
Tell him, Aiden.
It's not. You're a liar.
Got
not
him.
Good.
Got him. You guys want to hear more about this bowling stuff?
Yeah, I do want to hear more about the bowling stuff.
So he tweeted, this was at 8:08, so 33 minutes ago. After talking to the Fort Dodge bowling coach, Nick Vinson, what happened today was heartbreaking. The way he handled should make Fort Dodge alumni and parents proud that he is a leader of this team. They should not be proud for this leader. He let his team use cell phones. Doesn't really say what they did. It just says they got a quote from someone that said it's a rule in the book that they send out that states no cell phones or electronic devices in the competition area.
So how would a cell phone help somebody make them bowl better? Because I've taken my cell phone bowling quite often, and it does not help.
Can confirm.
That's it. Let's go protest. Let's drive to Fort Dodge right now.
Well, do we have to?
Tomorrow's problem.
I'm looking on ESPN right now on their WAR rankings.
Stop. Yadier Molina's trash. He had to use Stick'Em just to even throw the ball. He also invented
an entire new category of catching skill, which is pitch framing.
Which is trash.
Pitch framing is a crucial part of
I'm catching. Not talking about pitch framing. I'm talking about Yadier Molina being trash. He also invented the trash can because he looks like one.
He's also a very good hitter for his position.
No, he's not.
Yes, he is.
Once again, there is no correlation between offense and defense.
What does that have to do with that thing?
You keep saying that if they play a certain position, they're supposed to be a good hitter.
Yeah, there's actually WAR is adjusted per position, like catchers.
Yeah, I'm saying
historically
it's dumb.
Catchers are.
I'm
not
saying
good
you're
hitters.
Overrating it. Yeah,
catchers are not good hitters historically. Yadier Molina is, you know, compared to all players, not a great hitter, but compared to catchers, he's a very good hitter. Compared to shortstops, Javi Baez is a very bad hitter.
What you're telling me is compared to bad players, Yadier Molina is not that bad. Polish a turd, it's still a turd.
This is nonsense. I can't argue with Cubs fans. They're stupid.
You don't even watch baseball.
See, the problem is, like, we don't even have to stick up for Javi Baez anymore because he's not on our
he's
team.
Not even
you still have the trash can behind home plate. Yadier Mowiener.
Nice.
I'm going to use that now. I'm just going to, if Yadier Molina gets into the Hall of Fame, I'm going to go into Cooperstown and just stand out there. And
he's going to get in the Hall of Fame.
Okay,
the question is whether he's a first ballot Hall of Fame.
That's what I was going to say. And I'm going to say no, but now hear me out. It is impossible to be a first ballot Hall of Fame.
It's really hard.
That's the only reason I say he won't be a first ballot.
He's a lock for the Hall of Fame.
And listen. The Baseball Hall of Fame is a complete sham.
Yeah.
Well, it is
also,
and it isn't.
We're processing the NFL Hall of Fame until further notice.
The Baseball Hall of Fame is also just really hard to get into.
The Baseball Hall of Fame is just a stupid process that needs to be changed up because a bunch of stupid old dumbass writers get to vote on people they don't even care about anymore.
I don't disagree, but there are very, very few players that are in the Baseball Hall of Fame that don't deserve to be there.
I don't care if Barry Bonds juiced his arm up a couple
times. No, what I'm saying though is like The Baseball Hall of Fame is just super exclusive. It's probably more exclusive than it needs to be, but it's also better than Basketball's Hall of Fame, which is a joke because everybody gets in the Basketball Hall.
I do not care if it's exclusive or not. The people who have been sitting on those ballots forever that should be in,
I don't like the process either. I don't know if Yachty will get in first team, just like you said, Aiden. It's super hard to get in on the first ballot.
That's the only reason I wouldn't say he's the first
Yachty
ballot.
Yachty is a lock for the Hall of Fame.
I agree with that.
He's a lock and a half. I mean,
But it's kind of funny how baseball is so hard, but with basketball, it's like
the Basketball Hall of Fame is a joke.
Anyone.
If you scored a buck in the NBA, you're in, baby. Like is James Jones in the Hall of Fame because he was on a bunch of championship teams do anything? Yeah. He's got to be in there.
I get people hate the steroid thing, but it's like move on. Like we're past it. Sammy Sosa, Mark McGwire, Barry Bonds, all those guys were
you have to do is make a wing that's dedicated to the steroid era and say these guys are really good in the era they were played in, and that's all it is.
Like Barry Bonds, Sammy Sosa, Mark McGwire were like some of the greatest hitters of all time, even regardless of having
Barry Bonds was a Hall of Famer before he did steroids.
Yeah, like all three of those guys were like really good at just swinging the bat and making contact. No matter where the fucking ball was, they'd hit it. And they're being punished, I guess, for shit that happened 20 years ago, whatever. But
yeah,
it's dumb.
Sammy
Sosa is better than Mark McGwire, though.
Pete Rose should be in the Hall of Fame. Like,
yeah. My thing with Pete Rose is like if he was betting on his team to lose and then
he was betting on him to
win. He's betting on the team to win.
Right. Which is kind of ballsy in baseball considering how many games baseball even
and how
the
how
best
random
baseball
it is.
Teams of all time win like 60% of their games.
Right.
So it's the odds are still pretty solid that they're gonna lose. So it's like I don't know.
Yeah, I would fully get it if he was betting for them to lose.
Yeah. 100%.
And then
if he was point shaving, that'd be a different whole deal. Yeah.
Right.
Next Hall of Fame thing. The NFL Hall of Fame should be burned to the ground for not letting Devin Hester in.
Yep.
I mean, he's gonna get in, but
doesn't matter.
He gets in, we burn it down.
It's like the Joker gif. It's not about the money, it's about sending a message. All right.
So here you go. Devin Hester doesn't deserve to get in any more than Yachty does.
Wow.
Because Yachty, one of Yachty's big things is that he basically invented pitch framing, which is a specialty part of the position. Devin Hester, he was the best ever at returns. But the rest of the rest of the football.
Look, he caught touchdown passes from Jay Cutler. All right,
he did almost nothing as a receiver. So
elite receiver. All right, speed can blow right by any corner. Now, if he caught it after that, it doesn't matter. All right. Can you say Yachty or Molina return the opening kickoff of the Super Bowl for touchdown once?
Can you say
I bet Devin Hester could get behind home plate and frame a pitch once.
Can you say that Devin Hester was the sole reason that team stole base on his team at a 30% rate lower than the rest of the league?
Can you say Yachty or Molina was the whole reason why the NFL doesn't allow you to return kicks anymore other than concussions?
I feel like concussions is pretty much the big driver there. I gotta be honest. I feel like concussions is the driver.
No,
there.
It was all Devin Hester.
Is that what it was? Yes, he was just too good.
The Windy City Flyer, man.
Something like that.
While we're on the talk of Football Hall of Famers, I saw that Matt Nagy was trending on Twitter.
Oh boy.
Which I'm not saying Matt Nagy's a Hall of Famer. It's who's following is a Hall of Famer. Bills QB, Josh Allen, on Mitch Trubisky, Hall of Fame quarterback Mitch Trubisky, said, "The dude is an athlete. I don't think people really understand that. You give him leeway in an offense to have the mindset of, see it, do it, we trust you. He's going to kill it."
He plays football. He's not an athlete.
If he played basketball, he'd already be a Hall of Famer.
Yeah.
So can we talk about, Lovie Smith was just hired as the Texans coach again, and like people were pissed about it. But like, if you go back and like look at like Lovie Smith's tenure as like the Bears, like how many Hall of Famers are going to come out of that team as he coached? Because you're going to have Urlacher, Hester, probably Peanut Tillman, Lance Briggs. I mean, there you already got four. Like Jesus Christ, and the dude didn't win a Super Bowl. Absolutely nutty.
Yeah, Matt Forte, I would think, would be kind of.
And Matt Forte was really freaking good, too.
Yeah, he might be. I don't think he'll get in, but he'd be fringe.
He didn't ever win an MVP, did he?
He never won an MVP. Never won.
So like, that's what kind
of his team success wasn't great. And he was like, he's in the hall of really good. Like that's
he was kind of like the Christian McCaffrey before Christian McCaffrey, and like the Bears just ran everything through him. Like
except for Matt Forte wasn't made of glass.
Let him run.
Yeah.
But that just goes to show you, like, the Bears are still, the Bears are the Bears. Because, like, those teams had, like, Brandon Marshall, Alshon Jeffrey. Like, Lovie Smith had all these guys, right? Yeah. Brandon Marshall, Alshon Jeffrey on the same team with Jay Cutler and Matt Forte still didn't do anything. Julius Peppers on the other side of the ball in his prime still. What else? Brian Urlacher still on that team. Lance Briggs on the team. Peyton Tillman, all these guys all at one time.
Yeah.
Nothing. Didn't know I was going to cry tonight.
I don't know. The Texans, as far as football franchises go, I mean, the Jags are their own special kind of suck, but the Texans right now are lurking on total poverty franchise.
Their defense will probably be pretty decent, but like the offense, like who knows?
I mean, their offense is going to be bad forever as long as Deshaun Watson isn't playing. So,
I mean, they got a good offensive mind as their coordinator, Pep Hamilton, but quarterback.
They don't have anybody. Yeah, they don't have anybody to throw the ball. But whatever. What else we got for questions?
Nothing really crazy.
Nothing too much. Is there anything we wanted to talk about with Iowa State basketball? We're at 52 minutes of a show already, so I don't know how much we want to keep going.
I mean, we can talk about some women's basketball.
We can talk about that.
Because the Twister Sisters are in first place in Big 12.
Number six, right?
Number nine.
Maybe it's a different poll.
You need to stop reading things upside down.
No, it must have been a different poll that they're up number six.
We were six last week.
Ah, okay, yes.
Rankings have since come out.
Ah.
Oh, and also we are WBCA, Women's Basketball College Association. We are ranked sixth in that.
Okay, maybe that's what I saw.
That is as well as the USA Today poll. So literally the only poll that does matter, we're ranked ninth and the other ones were sixth.
Yeah. Yeah, it is what it is. But man, I'm really happy to see how good this team is.
I know. Because I think a lot of us had high hopes for this year.
Yeah.
And to see
that actually come to fruition.
Right. Yeah.
And especially in Ashley Jones' senior year, like all that. It's nice to see that this team is as good as advertised, or even mm-hmm. maybe a little bit better.
Yeah, so right now we are obviously tied first in the Big 12 with Baylor with four games remaining, I believe. Yeah, so we're at Kansas tomorrow, home against Texas Tech on Saturday, home against Baylor Monday, big Monday, 6 o'clock, ESPN2, be there. And we close the season March 5th at West Virginia. So pretty much we control our own destiny since we still play Baylor. Which is nice.
Right.
But Kansas is, I don't know if you guys paid attention to Kansas women's basketball for like the last decade. They've
been really bad, right?
Horrible. Absolutely horrible. Same coach. I don't know what happened. But all of a sudden, they're 10-4 in the conference, 19-5 overall.
Well, you see, Aiden, here's what happened. They started winning more games than they lost. That's what happened.
Oh. Thank you.
That's the hard-hitting analysis you come to us for. Well, that's good.
I mean, you didn't know what happened. I just wanted to make sure you knew. Also, I don't pay attention to anything.
It looks like within the last hour, we've offered a lineman. Yeah, left tackle, Jatavius Shivers.
Real question is, was he drafted in the USFL draft?
He was not.
By my sources, it says no.
Because he is in high school. I'm going to see if I can find him on 247 because we do have a history of offering guys that are not even on 247 and then they show up later and they end up being really good players. Jatavius Shivers. There he is. Currently not ranked. 247 has him as an 84, so kind of a mid 3-star. 6'6", 290 out of Villa Rica, Georgia. Something like that.
In terms of men's basketball, though, you know, get West Virginia on a one night's rest tomorrow, And then you go on the road to Kansas State. So if you beat West Virginia, if they could steal the Kansas State game on Saturday, for considering if they win tomorrow, that like negates all their Hilton losses that they like, other than Kansas really and Baylor, but and it gets them kind of right back in the middle of it all. But that'd get them to 20 wins before the season's even over, regular season wise. So that'd be cool. And the goal is really not to have to play in the Wednesday game.
Yes.
Right.
To go play Kansas the next day. Although, whatever. But if they stay out of that Wednesday game, things will be looking good. Because if they fall into that Wednesday game, that means things have gone horribly wrong in the next 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Not saying tomorrow, you can't, like, it's a must win, but like it's one that they should win.
If you win tomorrow, you're just about locked in the tournament.
Well, so. I think as of today, when Lenardi sent out his little bracketology.
Yeah, we're not on Twitter, the bubble anymore. So that's...
No, I think he gave us an 85% plus to make the chance to make
so,
the tournament.
So here's a philosophical question for you. If you are constantly on and off the bubble, are you really just on the bubble the whole time?
You're on the bubble of the bubble.
Right. So but like if you're on and off the bubble all season, which we weren't, we were actually way above the bubble. We were like projected as a one seed for a while. Times were simpler there. We're simpler then. Yeah. So, but I don't know.
You just answered your own question by asking the question.
If we keep going on and off the bubble, it feels like we're just on the bubble and we're on the bubble until we're not.
No. The thing is, if you're on the bubble, you're on the bubble. If you're off the bubble, you're not on the bubble.
But if you're off the bubble, but if you're just off the bubble, then
you're off the bubble. You're
functionally on the bubble, because as soon as you lose, you're immediately on the bubble.
But then you would be on the bubble once you get put on the bubble. Oh, it'd definitely be me. My left stroke goes viral, dude.
Well, Aiden is shot 100% in high school. So.
Yeah, people forget.
Oh, I didn't even see they had Aiden in there. I thought it just said Levi or Matias. I mean, if it's just Levi or Matias, he's going down. Left stroke goes viral, dude.
I'm just an okay outside shooter. Like I definitely don't have like a super.
If it's just it's so, can we do?
I will say I'm probably a better defender than Matias, but he could be a better shooter than me.
Have you ever been tossed into a mat because you stole the ball from me? That's how good of a defender I am. One kid stole the ball from me. This is why they buy playing time.
No.
I'm an intimidator, all right? Let's go story time, since Aiden got the one last time for his high school career, right? Or you guys were talking about how you guys didn't play that much in high school or whatever. Same story. Not because I couldn't play basketball. I think it's because I did dumb things, right?
No way.
So never.
I was.
Did you eat a hot dog for every quarter?
Yes. I mean, do you look at me and right now, do I scream point guard to you? The answer is no. So why I was in the position to be a point guard in the first place in this particular game, I don't know. I still ask this question this day. But anyways, point guard, bring the ball up. I don't know. I don't dribble well. I'm just catch and shoot type of guy, or down the post, throw some elbows, grab a rebound every once in a while. I would bring up the ball. Kid stole the ball from me. I got pissed. He was going up for a layup. I grabbed him, threw him into the mat.
Were you allowed to play the rest of the game?
No.
Immediately took him out.
I was done after that one.
Yeah, that happens. Don't scream! Well, don't scream point guard. More like yell bench. Yes.
Speaking of basketball, a quick update on my intramural team. Won the division. I know you guys were up at night.
Yeah.
Worrying about whether we won or not.
I was trying to find the stream, but I couldn't. There was no illegal stream of it.
Anyway, that's my story. Yeah.
that was the whole story.
That's the update.
Good stuff.
We don't know our next game yet, but.
I think it's about time to call it for this week. I think we're running out of shit.
We can play games.
We can. I don't have any trivia. I don't have any trivia questions lined up.
We'll just do
old heads, new trends.
All right, we'll do it. Old heads, new trends.
That was Pushing P. I just sure. that song came on my Spotify the other day, just randomly. I was like, nice.
That song sucks.
Yeah, it wasn't the greatest.
8 foot dunk contest. Who wins?
I don't know if I can even jump that high to get
on an. I could dunk on an 8 foot hoop.
Wait, I'm 6. If I can't dunk on an 8 foot,
it'd be pretty embarrassing if you could. Probably Aiden, because he's the youngest of us and not old and fat.
Honestly, if I do like anything to win an 8 foot, any type of dunk contest at this point in time, I'd probably pull a muscle and be done within the first dunk.
You'd have to do like the Shaq where you like pull up and you kick your legs out type of thing.
This is, we're talking about the guy that I literally had a back spasm by plugging in an iPhone charger for my daughter's iPad. Literally a Saturday morning knocked me out the entire, I had to go to urgent care on Sunday morning to get painkillers and muscle relaxers just to move.
That's hilarious.
It was the worst experience of my entire life.
You're so old.
It was, I do not recommend that for anyone. It was the worst thing ever. Talk about a weekend killer. That was it.
Yeah.
Jesus.
All right. Old heads, new trends.
Okay. So who did Kanye West say Pete Davidson dated during Kanye's latest Instagram tear? I don't know if you guys are aware of this.
Pete Davidson dated?
Yeah. But Kanye just went ape shit on
He dated
Instagram
Kim.
And Twitter.
He dated Kim for a while. But
well, they're still dating. Yeah,
it is.
But oh, so yeah. Kanye is basically saying, like, I want my family back. So he hates Pete Davidson right now.
Yeah, right. Kanye's mad online right now.
He said Pete Davidson dated some. Okay, is it? I do want one hint. Is it like an?
Is it an old nasty person?
Is it an actor / actress, or is it, or is it like a TikTok celebrity?
I will answer a yes or no question. I feel like that's fair.
Oh, is it a female?
That's the only one you get.
Is it a singer?
No.
Betty White.
No.
I'm going to say, are they over or under 30?
Over.
Is it like totally off the wall?
Yes.
Oh. Jennifer Aniston.
Barbara Streisand.
No. Since you guys both got it wrong.
Okay.
I'll give you one hint. Her husband did not have sexual relations with that woman.
Hillary Clinton?
Yes.
He said he dated Hillary Clinton?
Yes. So random.
Yes. That is super random. So Pete Davidson was a big Hillary Clinton supporter when she ran for president. Right. And I believe I think he's gotten all his tattoos removed. But at one point, he had a Hillary Clinton tattoo. So Kanye posted a picture of Davidson and Hillary Clinton and said that they dated or hooked up or something.
Why is that? Like, Pete Davidson, I'd be like, so what?
Whatever. That's wild.
Yeah.
Cool trash talk, Kanye. That really hurt my feelings.
What's next?
All right. Finish the lyric. Okay, ready?
Finish the lyric. This thing was a masterpiece till you tore it off. I don't know.
It's my time. I don't know. I've heard the song before, but I don't know the lyrics.
I don't know.
We're probably gonna get this video removed from Facebook again for copyright laws because Aiden did that last time. They were watching us, Adele.
They remember really?
There are some artists that have agencies that watch like hawks for that stuff.
Got a notification that next morning that said your video has been removed for copyright. Copyright infractions. Oh, well, that's part of the course.
I got nothing on the lyric. I have no idea.
Me either. No idea.
Nothing?
Nope.
So do you want me to just play it? Or do you want me to tell the lyric? Or
just tell us what the lyric is.
I'll just play it.
Okay.
Jesus. Maybe this thing was a masterpiece till you tore it off.
Down. yeah, would have never got that.
I didn't expect you to do all of it. I expected like the next 10 words or so.
I don't not like Taylor Swift, but I don't like her that much, I guess.
It's a sad, sad life you live, man.
She's fine.
All right. The Urban Dictionary word of the day definition is to be incriminated with concrete digital evidence, typically on social media / on film.
What?
Do you want me to repeat it, or are you just confused?
Yeah, repeat it.
Repeat it.
To be incriminated with concrete digital evidence, typically on social media / on film.
Can you use it in a sentence?
Still no.
Read the definition one more time.
To be incriminated with concrete digital evidence.
This is canceled, right?
Typically on social media / on film.
Canceled.
No.
Really? Okay.
I was gonna say
that seems like canceled to me.
I would say.
Oh,
being canceled.
Is it cancel adjacent?
Kind of, sort of, not really.
Okay.
I don't know. You'll understand when I say the words.
Is it?
It's a phrase, by the way.
Caught in 4K.
Yes, it is.
Oh,
I remember seeing a GIF. I just GIF clicked in my head. That's why I saw a GIF that said caught in 4K. I'm like, I don't know what that means, but.
Well, I just told you what it means. Yeah. So see what I mean, Levi? Like, it wasn't really canceling, but I think it could
definitely lead you to getting canceled.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
I've seen that one because people.
I've seen the phrase before. I just didn't. It didn't click in my head at all. Yeah.
I better check on the USFL draft. I've been falling behind.
I was good old fashioned 0-for-3 on the old heads, new trends there.
That was
easily the most common result on that game.
New trends.
So, are you ready to do a wrap up for this week?
Yeah, unless Matias has anything else from the USFL.
Yeah, any
the your recent most recent pick. We're on to cornerbacks now. We went through a wave.
Hey, Ann Bassett checking in. Hey, Ann. Someone send me an address. I can.
Hey, Ann.
We can get you that for sure. We really appreciate it. Thank you.
Devontae Bosby, New Jersey Generals cornerback, 8th round pick 3. From Pittsburgh State. Looks like he had a run with the Broncos.
There you go.
That name sounds familiar.
How about that? Trivia question. Where is Pittsburgh State?
Kansas.
Kansas.
It isn't Kansas, yeah.
Yeah, everyone knows that. What a silly question.
What's their mascot?
Panthers?
Aren't they?
The Panthers.
It's gorillas.
It is the gorillas, yeah. Yeah. Right. It's the gorillas, yeah. Anyways.
Is that all we got?
That's all I got.
Pittsburgh State, rise up. New Jersey Generals, rise up.
We are back. We have arrived.
New Orleans Breakers. This is officially a New Orleans Breakers podcast.
Wrong.
Okay, listen. You don't get to make that choice because you don't even know what TV station they're on.
Yeah.
All right?
Yeah, you're right. I don't.
Do you remember what they are?
The New Orleans Breakers?
No, the TV station.
NBC and Fox.
Lucky guess.
Okay.
Almost.
I knew NBC was one of them, but
he almost had to be terminated from the payroll of the USFL podcast.
All right, Aiden, let's wrap her up.
All right, for Matias Schwarzkopf, Levi Stevenson, I'm Aiden White, reporting you from the official USFL podcast in the state of Iowa. Go Cyclones! We'll be right back.